What a tremendous opportunity we have to alter history at a time when there's so much division in our country, a time when we need peace right here in the United States of America, a time we need healing. We have the opportunity to alter history as we discover the power of prayer and take serious what Jesus says to us in Matthew 7:7. He says, "Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you." How we need to ask, seek, and knock at this hour. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I'm coming to you right now, my brothers and my sisters. Lord, we're coming to you at this moment in the history of our country. So much hurt, so much pain, so much need for healing in so many areas. Oh, Lord God, all things are possible for you. And we come to you and ask you, Lord, to pour your Holy Spirit out. Let there be peace. Let there be your presence. Let there be the power of your love at this urgent hour. In Jesus' name we ask this. Amen. What a mighty God we serve. And how we need to each and every one of us understand the power of prayer. Andrew Murray, in response to an invitation to pray, stated, "We must begin to believe that God, in the mystery of prayer, has entrusted us with a force that can move the heavenly world and bring its power down to earth." Knowing that the question is that God is a mighty God, why does he want us to pray? Because he wants to develop a relationship with us. And he also explicitly tells us in Luke chapter 18, verse 7, "And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night?" The time has come for us to wake up from our indifference and our powerlessness and begin to pray for justice. Justice does not mean just us. It means the power of God moving among so many that are suffering at this time, suffering from being homeless, suffering from being poor, experiencing the coronavirus in record numbers. How we need to begin to pray at this particular time that God will just pour out his Spirit and we will see justice, unity, and peace unfold in our country. When he's told us that by praying we can make such a big difference, why is it that we just do not take prayer serious? Or maybe it's just a shot of religion before we go to sleep at night, like, you know, "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep," and then pass out. Well, what about the prayer that will get us on our knees and cause us to be awakened to the fact that God is in control, that he has told us that he will answer prayer, and how we need saints praying at this particular time? So much time is wasted and by so many at this time that are arguing over this political thing and that political thing, and they're breeding division and hatred and bitterness. We should be calling the people to pray and begin to pray with power and begin to let there be love unfolding in the midst of our society at this particular moment. I was touched that one of the first acts that when President Biden was about to become president, he first wanted to call both Republicans and Democrats to prayer and had a special mass before he became inaugurated as president. He wanted to start with prayer and how we need to continue to pray, that prayer will be a very focal point in our society at this particular time, how we need to begin to come together and pray for peace. Yes, Jesus has explicitly told us in his word that if we pray, it's going to bring about change. And you and I need to begin to receive this. It's prayer that breathes life into this culture of death that we see all around us. It's prayer that gives hope where people may be feeling hopeless. It's prayer that invigorates each and every one of us to the reality of the living God. President Biden would speak frequently about how prayer sustained him after the death of his wife and daughters, and then later his son. And how many of you could testify at this particular moment to the power of prayer in your life, if only we'll begin to pray. And that, I mean, just really, I can give a whole sermon on prayer, but nothing is like individually, each and every one of us experiencing the power of prayer in our lives to the extent that we suddenly experience this peace that passes all understanding, and we can get up from our knees knowing that we've had a direct encounter with the divine. That has never happened in your life? Well, have you ever really spent time in prayer? Or has it just been an occupation of all these other thoughts? I mean, it's a battle sometimes. In order to effectively pray, there has to be a victory within our own hearts and minds to move into this spirit of peace that passes all understanding first in our life before this peace can flow from us into the lives of others. And so that's why we continue to go to the Word of God. And we continue to look and see the power of God. Prayer is just so powerful that we begin to see even in Revelation chapter 8, verses 4 through 5, the smoke of the incense rose with the prayers of the saints from the hand of the angel before God. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar and threw it to the earth, and there were peals of thunder, voices flashing of lightning, and an earthquake. George Herbert referred to this as reversed thunder. And he went on and said, prayers, reversed thunder, he says. Christ's side-piercing spear, the six-day world transposing in an hour. Wow, the power of prayer. We often think of things coming from heaven down here and changing things, but he says that verse thunder results in our prayers that go up to heaven and things start changing there. Oh, we need prayer at this particular time. They've tried this, that, and the other to bring the coronavirus to an end. But what will really bring about is prayer. Begin to pray that God will use the vaccine. Begin to pray that people will see the need to wear masks and social distance and engage with and washing their hands. Begin to pray that there'll be a change of attitude. And as we're praying for the coronavirus to come to an end, let's pray for our economy, as so many are suffering at this time, finding themselves homeless, finding themselves hurting. We need so much prayer at this time. No matter the good intentions of any leader, unless it's backed up by prayer, and that's why the Bible says, pray for those who are in authority. Pray for wisdom, that peace might indeed come to our country at this particular hour. Let's go to God and let's pray and let's believe Him for miracles. Let's believe Him for miracles at this particular time. Let's continue to focus in God's Word. Look at the power that He says we have here in Matthew chapter 18, verses 19 and 20. He says, again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it'll be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, there I am with them. Two or three coming together in the name of our resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I made reference to the mass that President Biden had before he got inaugurated as president. What's so unique is that he invited both Democrats and Republicans and people from all different faiths and persuasions to come together and begin at this very crucial time in American history in prayer. But we can't just leave it up to our leaders. Each and every one of us who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ need to begin to pray for our country, that there may be healing and that there may be hope and that we'll begin to experience the Lordship of Jesus, not just in word. There's a lot of groups running around out here yaking the name of Jesus. Even when the insurrection was taking place, when they're charging the Capitol, some guy was carrying a banner of with Jesus' name on it. What profanity. We need to live it, not just advertise it. We need to let Jesus be Lord. And if Jesus is not Lord of all, then all the activity and activism and all the things that we say and do just will come to nothing. In order for Jesus to be Lord of our life, we first have to let Him be Lord of our prayers. In other words, we need to come talk to Him. For my prayer is not vocalized worry. It's laying our burdens down before God. It's standing on the promises of God. When He says, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. He tells us this because He means it. He wants us to just ask. Again, the divine creator and ruler of the universe would really care that much about having us talk to Him, us relating to Him, us engaging in a relationship with Him. Why do you think He sometimes wakes you up in the middle of the night? You try so hard to go back to sleep, begin to pray. And there's peace to sweep over you, you'll go right back to sleep. Maybe there's troubling in your spirit that you think that somehow if you just, have another drink, smoke a cigarette, or maybe you don't do that, but you just eat and eat and eat, you'll find some kind of peace. It's not there. Let's go before God. And let's experience His peace that passes all understanding. Prayer in the life of the prayer warrior becomes the theater where one battles the principalities and powers of this world. First, they're overcome by the power of the Holy Spirit as it begins to work on their self-centered desires until Jesus becomes Lord of their life. Then that we see that Jesus not only gives us a new start, He gives us a new heart. He's a mighty, mighty God. And He wants to give us a new start. If anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. So instead of dragging the garbage of before, and it's often hard to pray with somebody you haven't forgiven, let's forgive one another. And let's let Him give us a new heart. And as we receive His forgiveness, we let His forgiveness flow from us into the lives of others. True prayer is not just talking to God with our mouth. It's praying often with our senses. And that's why I speak frequently of going on these prayer walks in the middle of creation. And what we can do is we can begin to just begin to taste and see and feel and hear and experience the beauty of God as we're just walking, whether it's in the park or out in the woods. And if you're not able to do that, just go out in the backyard and look up into the sky. Feel the wind blowing. Breathe the fresh air. Let the Holy Spirit speak to your heart. And watch the Lord do exceedingly beyond what you can even ask or think. What a mighty God we serve. How we need to come and lay ourselves before Him. When we do pray like this, we behold God's wonders and beauty in creation. It enables us to live in the now. And we're able to drop a lot of our worries to the side as we see that tree that stood there for many, many years, whether it's through cold weather, warm weather, good weather, bad weather, droughts, rain, whatever, it's still standing. And you and I can remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work of God as we continue to go to God in prayer. How we need to come and experience His power within us at this particular time. We try so hard to do things ourselves. It's like the man who went out and bought a car. And only the guy wasn't even aware of the power that was in the engine. So he pushed that car here, there, and everywhere. Until finally one day someone came to him and says, "There's an engine in that car. It's such a burden for you. It doesn't have to be that way. Go in there and turn the ignition switch and look at that engine. Power the car." So many today, their faith has become such a burden to them. Their religiosity is what's become, and it's become a burden to them. And they're trying to push it themselves when there's an engine in there. The power of the Holy Spirit and prayer is that ignition that turns the key, and suddenly an explosion begins to take place. How we need that power of prayer and the engine of prayer to unfold in our country at this particular time. Nothing is too hard for God. Nothing is too hard for God. Think of the prayers of the saints who were held in slavery years ago as they continued to pray, someday knowing that there would be a liberty, and there was. And in the midst of that civil war when so many were dying, except those that continued to pray. And yes, God prevailed, and He'll do the same thing today if we'll but come to Him in prayer. Nothing is too hard for God. He'll take those feelings of bitterness and hatred and resentment, the fears of the future from you, a fear of a culture that may be going through a lot of changes at this time, fears that torment you as you see all the signs approaching that these are the last days, and you'll know that there is hope, that Christ is going to return, and there's hope both now and for all eternity. So prayer warriors are people that are getting better, not bitter. And we can go before God, and we can begin to pray at this particular hour. How we need to begin to pray. How we need to begin to pray. Well, 2 Peter chapter 1, 3 and 4 says, "His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of Him who's called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these, He's given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world." Wow. Talk about the promises of God that are unfolding around us. Well, some would say, "Well, why pray? God knows what He's going to do anyway. Why pray?" Well, here's a classical answer that that is given to us by Peter Kreeft. And he says, "We pray to let God be God. Prayer is our obedience to God, even when it asks God for things. For God has commanded us to pray in Matthew 7:7. Prayer gives truth to our mind, goodness to our will, and beauty to our heart." How we need that in our country at this time. And how we need to begin to pray for peace. First, experiencing that peace that passes all understanding in our lives as we go to God in prayer. And then we begin to pray for our nation. We begin to pray for our nation that we can come together, people of all different backgrounds. And once again, we can experience the United States of America as we let God's peace prevail in the midst of it. Yes, let's pray for peace. Now remember, prayer is not vocal worrying. It's not vocalizing, saying, help me, God. It's not begging. It's not whining. It's moving as winners, not whiners. For we're more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. It's talking to the Lord, the creator of heaven and earth. So nothing is too hard for God. Even in the midst of a country that's being ravaged by coronavirus, being divided with all these different political ideas, a time in which there's so much hatred, we can come together and we can experience peace. And first, we need to experience it in our own lives. Stop listening to all this garbage out here where people are feeding you, and they're even using God and taking it out of context and feeding you a bunch of hate and bitterness and fear for the future. Come into the Word of God. Get to know what the Word of God is. Know what Jesus means when He says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest." We can experience His rest. We can experience His peace at this particular time. You and I can have it at this moment. But let me give you a simple formula. for prayer. Perhaps you've heard me say this before, but I have to remind you to do it because it's so easy to just get down, begin to pray for a little while, and then get anxious and then get up and run. We need to actually discover that prayer results in actions, and you can spell out the word acts. And the A, the first step in our prayers, is adoration. We get down before God. That's why kneeling is important. I mean, I do a lot of praying just laying in bed. Yes, praying as I'm driving around the road, praying when I'm walking. But there has to be that time in my life. And so that's why I have this little carpet beside my bed. And I'll get down on that, or I'll get down on the carpet in the living room, put my head on the couch. But I have to just come in honor and in adoration unto God, acknowledge that He is God, and I must kneel down and worship Him. When I go for a walk and out in creation, I just can't help but just praise God. So adoration is the A. How we need to just come to God and recognize that God is bigger than all the affairs in this country and around the world. And let's continue to go before God, and let's just call out on Him. So that's the A, adoration, and the word acts. The C is confession, where we can be honest. The Lord woke me up this morning, and He was just showing me that I had to put the brakes in a lot of areas of my life because I was running here, running there, running this, doing this, and I just had to stop and ask the Lord to forgive me for all this needless running and just let Him come on the throne of my life and let Him reorganize my day and my life. Confession. That we as a people can confess that we have forgotten God. That we've forgotten God in this country. We may have God, and God we trust on our dollar bills, but He's just not there. Humanism has come and taken over so much of our country. Humanism has begun to saturate so much of the way we act. We're to the point where we become practical atheists, living life like God's not there, always with a plan B if God don't come through. So we've got to confess our sins. Coronavirus is not only trying to get the attention of the people in this country, but around the world. We need to, as a people, ask God to forgive us. As we move from adoration to confession, let's go to the T for thanksgiving. Let's thank God for His mercy. Let's thank God for a second chance. Let's thank God for His divine intervention. Let's thank God that He preserved our democracy at a very crucial time in history on January 6th, 2021. Let's thank God for His divine intervention. Let's thank God for the new things that He is doing at this particular time. So after we've engaged in adoration, after we engage in confession, thanksgiving, let's go to the Lord with supplication. That means we ask Him. So we've gone through three basic steps before we even ask Him anything, because we want to win this battle that's going on inside of us. We want to get our head right, our heart right. We want to know that we're coming before an almighty God. Well, my mighty God that has mercy on us, and blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. As we confess our sins and want forgiveness, we're willing to forgive all those people that we feel have hurt us. And then thank Him. And then supplication. Finally, we're at a point we can begin to ask. And we ask in faith. Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Whatever two or three agree on earth, it's agreed upon in heaven. Faith can move and will move mountains. We're facing mountains at this particular time. Let's pray for our president. Let's pray for those that are in authority. Let's begin to pray that God will just move in a great and mighty way. And yes, peace and healing will come to our country. For He's promised that in His word at this particular moment. And let's pray for the end of COVID-19, racism, let's pray for an end of it. Let's pray for an end to just the economic turmoil that's taking place at this time. And let's pray for justice to come to all, to the fatherless, the widow, the hurting, and the homeless. And as we engage in supplication, remember spelling out the word acts, let's engage in our acts of compassion following it. Let's get up and let's help those that are in need. Let's let the light and love of God flow through us. Because we've turned the ignition switch. The engine's running. We're moving forward. We're not pushing it from place to place. We've got an infilling of the Holy Spirit as a result of answers to prayer. We've stood on the promises of God. Yes, the promises of God. And they become a part of our lives. And we begin to see God do a new work within us. That's why He tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. So we don't have to push our religion. And that's the problem, that there's so much bitterness and hatred. People think that somehow we have to push our religion. Somehow they think that we have to push it. No, we just want to come before God. We want to surrender to Him. We want to turn the ignition switch through prayer. And we want the engine to reinvigorate it. So let's continue to trust Him at this particular moment. Let's believe God at this moment. We may not agree with everything that comes out of Washington, D.C., Jefferson City, Springfield, or wherever, but we can stand on the promises of God and know that He is in control. And so we're going to continue to pray. And so again, we need to pray at this moment. We need to pray at this moment. It took 10 plagues to get Pharaoh's attention, to bring him to his knees. How many plagues will it take for the people of God to wake up in this country and begin to pray? Can't say it enough. We can talk about it over and over and over, but until we actually do it, nothing's going to take place. Yes, in this country today, so many things detestable has become acceptable. Yes, there's abomination. Yes, there's sin all around us. All we can do is let our light so shine before men and women that may see our good works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. And we begin to pray. We begin to ask God to live in us and through us. But we know the power of intercessory prayer. We know that power. Intercessory prayer and the direction power of the Holy Spirit enables us to move into the limitless dimensions that God has given us at this moment. That we begin to move into the supernatural as we begin to trust Him. There's power in prayer. So again, turn that ignition switch of prayer on and let Him just begin to rev up the engine, because you can do exceedingly above beyond what you can ask or think. And let's move forward at this particular moment. What our ministry needs now more than ever before are fearless prayer warriors, fearless intercessory prayer warriors. As the New Testament points out, there's a spiritual battle underway. This battle requires each of us to put on the full armor of God. As Ephesians 6, 10 to 18 says, you fight not against flesh and blood, but principalities, powers, and spiritual forces. And it tells us to put on that full armor of God, take up the sharp two-edged sword, and move forward with the shield of faith, along with the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of the gospel of peace, the belt of truth, knowing that, yes, we're more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. God hasn't called us to be a defeated church. He's called us to be an all-powerful gathering of believers, people from all over that are focusing upon the Almighty right now, exercising our faith. And in spite of the obstacles and the odds, we're going to continue to be a people that God has called us to be. The question is, do you realize the power and potential of prayer? Ask yourself that. If so, how much time are you spending in prayer every day? Are you doing what He tells us? 1 Thessalonians, to pray without ceasing? Are you developing that relationship with the Almighty? Are you praying for your marriage, your ministry, for this country? Are you praying at this particular time? Again, if not, why not? And if you are, what priority does prayer take in your life? Is there more time engaging in social media with other people than there is engaging with God? Is there more time watching, whether it's TV or watching on your iPhone or whatever it may be, than there is with God? How much time each day do you spend on the internet or the iPhone? How much time do you spend in prayer? We don't need to feel guilty. We just need to get down before God and understand the joy of relationship. Understand that the uneasiness within us is the Holy Spirit prompting us to pray, and how we need to thank God that the Almighty really would want to relate to us in this way. You have not because you ask not, He says. And when you ask amidst to satisfy your own desires. Well, let's move beyond our desires and let's pray for the common good. Let's pray for peace at this particular time. And let's be a people who know that God is in control and know the power of prayer. In 1 Samuel chapter 12, verse 13, Saul, he's pretty frustrated with the guy that's king. Samuel is pretty frustrated with the guy who's king, and that's Saul. So yeah, Samuel's really frustrated with Saul. Saul just continues to blow it. He's become arrogant, become proud. He does things he shouldn't be doing, act like a priest when he's not. And we see there in 1 Samuel 12, 23, that Samuel goes to Saul, lays it all out before him, and says, I'm going to continue, though, to pray for you, Saul, lest I sin. So, you know, prayerlessness is sin. So we need to begin to pray at this particular time. And as we study the scriptures, we see that our prayers are not vocalized to worry, but they're acts of compassion. They're acts of relationship with a living, loving God who cares about each and every one of us. And remember what we read earlier? Luke chapter 18, verses 7 and 8, when Jesus makes it clear that earnest intercessory prayer performs a vital role in destroying the citadels of injustice, He said, will not God bring about justice for His chosen ones who cry out to Him day and night? Will He keep putting them off? I tell you, He will see they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will He find faith on the earth. How we need to be men and women of faith and earnestly pray at this hour. Almighty God, I come to you, my brothers and my sisters, Lord, and we pray for the United States of America. Oh, Almighty God, we come against this plague in the name of Jesus. This plague of bitterness, hostility, hatred, COVID-19, and social injustice. We pray, Lord God, for healing for our world that's been ravaged by this plague of COVID-19. We come before you and ask you to forgive us for our sins, Almighty God. We ask you to divinely intervene as we call upon the name of Jesus, who told us to ask and he'll be given. We're asking, we're believing, and we're receiving at this hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.